have done a magnificent job. The visual impact that people will experience when they see what you have produced, you've been very impartial in your presentation, and you have allowed the people, the viewers, to make up their own mind. You present the evidence, and anyway, it's an honor to have you on the program.
I want to say that the work that Dennis Wise has undertaken and accomplished and the value of this work cannot be underestimated at this time, especially. He has undertaken to present actual information about the most controversial period in human history. We have been given a narrative that has painted a picture, an image for the world to consume. And we have to look at this. The reason this is so important this time for everyone to look at is we have to challenge the lies. Okay, that's one thing right there, just from a moral standpoint. In our time today, it is more than that, just a morality. It is a matter of physical survival itself, because we have to look at this period and look at exactly what happened, which Dennis Wise has presented to us in his great accomplishment that he has put together there. We have to look at what happened. Who had power in 1945? It was Stalin, Churchill, and Roosevelt. And what did they do with this power? As again illustrated in his great work, The Greatest Story Never Told. Yes, if you want to see the dangers that are facing the world today, just watch this film. One can see the actual facts, indisputable facts, of what really happened at that time.
The story began here in the Austrian town of Braunau, with a child born in this house, Adolf Hitler. At his peak, the most popular ruler in Europe. The child born here in Braunau belonged to that handful of human beings who have clearly and decisively changed the history of the 20th century. Linz, Austria, the site of the only memorial to the Hitler family, the grave of Hitler's parents. Nothing about his parents or Adolf's early life gave any hint of the extraordinary career that was to come. His father, Alois, was a stern, short-tempered customs official who beat his son. His mother, Clara, tried to protect him. When she died, young Adolf was broken by grief. He kept her portrait with him for the rest of his life. The infant Adolf was baptized and brought up as a Catholic. At the age of 6, he entered the monastery school at Lambach. Soon, he was top of his class. Hitler was a chorister at the great Abbey Church of Lambach. I used, he said, to intoxicate myself with the solemn splendor of the services. Every day when he sang in the choir, he saw the memorial to an earlier abbot. Above it was an emblem which a quarter of a century later, Hitler was to adopt for the Nazi party, the swastika. In his teens, Hitler became a moody adolescent. At secondary school in Linz, he lost interest in most of his work. His ambition was to go to Vienna and become an artist or architect. Once there, he produced architectural drawings and watercolors like these. Competent, but not good enough to win the place he longed for at the Viennese Academy of Fine Arts. After the shock of being turned down twice by the Academy of Fine Arts, he became a drifter. Hitler later called his period in Vienna the most miserable time of my life. Three of those miserable years were spent here in a Viennese backstreet at this hostel for homeless men. In this depressing hostel, the future Führer passed much of the day sitting with other inmates, churning out drawings and watercolors which earned him a modest income. When he drifted from Vienna to Germany in 1913, he was still dreaming of becoming a great artist or famous architect. Munich, the 1st of August, 1914. A cheering crowd welcomes the outbreak of the First World War. On the right is a photographer, and among the crowd he's photographing is the 25-year-old Adolf Hitler. Now, for the first time, film has been discovered of Hitler at this turning point in his life, as he waits to enlist as a soldier.
If you look at the tenacity of his service, I mean, he's a fanatic. And he petitioned King Ludwig III of Bavaria to enlist in what's referred to as the King's Own Regiment. That's an elite Bavarian unit. He was accepted, but put in the 16th Bavarian Reserve Infantry. World War I is a major influence on Hitler's life. And he served his basic training without complaining. He was always willing to offer his fellow comrades help. He spoke about the evil of tobacco and alcohol to his fellow soldiers. They liked him because of his drawings that he did for them. He would do sketches for them. Remember, he sketched and did a variety of things, you know, in his youth, and was trying to get in the art school. So he really got along with his fellow soldiers. At one point, during the trench duties in between 14 and 18, he will have a dog. Somebody's going to steal from him at one point. Anyway, during World War I, Adolf Hitler repeatedly volunteered for hazardous duty. His first combat was October the 29th, 1914. Hitler's unit lost 3,000 of its 3,600 men after making 5 assaults on the enemy position. Now, Hitler had one of his sleeves shot off. That's a heck of a shot. He walked out of a tent where he'd been talking with some men, and a couple of seconds later, a shell hits it and blows at the Kingdom Come. And for his fighting in this unit, he was awarded the Iron Cross Second Class for bravery under fire, and he was promoted to corporal. So this is a well-deserved award. Later, he became a runner, which meant he moved messages from the rear to the front, and it's a very high mortality job, and he liked it. He always liked that job. Then in December of 1914, when you have the famous the accidental Christmas truce on December the 25th, Hitler wouldn't leave his trench. And his comment was, such a thing should not happen in wartime. And then he told his buddies that participated that they were wrong to get involved. So, no fun while the war goes on. Those are your enemies. Now, between 1914 and 1916, in the final stages of the Battle of the Somme, Adolf Hitler was wounded in the leg by a shell fragment. This was a home wound. This sent him back to Germany to recover, and he's there for about 5 months. Hitler could have stayed back in Germany on light duty, but demanded to be sent back to the front. So this is, he's no shirker. Got to give a guy some due here for not being a chicken. A lot of people, you know, look for a way to get out of there. Then you have Hitler back again on trench duty, and then he shows up again during the, of course, German offensives. Now, during the Ludendorff offensives, he was armed with a pistol, and he captured 5 French soldiers. And for that, he received the Iron Cross First Class. You didn't get those at any time in the war for free. Can't dismiss his decorations. So he wins the Iron Cross Second Class in 1914, First Class in 1918. He also at the same time received the Regimental Diploma for being wounded. And then in mid-October, he got another battlefield decoration. But he's never promoted because he had a captain. Captain Fritz Wiedemann said he lacked the capacity for leadership. You just can't make those statements. As the war turned against Germany, he believed that the pacifists and the shirkers, which are people trying to get out of duty, were losing the war. And the thing that enraged him even worse is what is referred to as defeatism in the ranks. They're actually non-commissioned officers that said it was stupid to keep fighting. He beat one up. So we have a corporal beating up a non-commissioned officer and didn't get into trouble for it. He's a fanatic. Now, the end of the war, Hitler was gassed by the British forces advancing near Ypres. It bloated his face up, and particularly his eyelids. Constantly watering eyes, had a hoarse voice. He then had this terrible pain. He referred to it, quote, piercing pain in my eye sockets, that he would remark later. Hitler hated leaving the front to go to the hospital. He considered it the happiest chapter in his life. Being there, being something, being with people. You know, he had friends and he had comrades while he was in the war. He was not a loner. He had the respect of his fellow soldiers. He was no longer a wandering vagabond like he had been, you know, in Vienna. He had purpose. By early November, Hitler's spirits had come back. And it was very common for people who had been gassed to plunge into depression because they're concerned about being blind the rest of their lives. On November the 9th, this is 2 days before the armistice, a local pastor came to the hospital and told the patients that on November the 8th that the Kaiser had abdicated and Germany was now a republic.
Defeat was followed by a humiliating peace at Versailles. The injustice of Versailles rankled with most Germans for the next 20 years. Unable to accept that the German army had lost the war, Hitler convinced himself that the soldiers had been stabbed in the back by communist revolutionaries and parliamentary politicians. The stab in the back, he believed, was part of a great Jewish conspiracy. Hitler's obsession with that calamity propelled him into politics. Suddenly, Hitler discovered the greatest talent he possessed, the gift of public speaking. He joined a small group of fanatical nationalists in Munich. They became the National Socialist German Workers' Party, or Nazis. In 1921, Hitler became their leader. The first film of the apprentice Führer campaigning shows him as still a rather awkward figure, not yet certain of his role as Germany's messiah. In 1923, Hitler felt strong enough to try and seize power in Munich. Emil Klein, the only stormtrooper still alive who marched with Hitler, now retraces their steps. Everything went well until the marchers found armed police blocking their exit from a narrow street.
Wir waren noch singend hier die Straße.
We were still singing as we marched down the street. and suddenly we heard shots being fired ahead of us. Procession stopped. We were speechless and couldn't explain what had happened until word came from the front of the march saying that Hitler was dead. I saw men with tears in their eyes. And I myself was very moved too, and had great difficulty keeping myself under control.
Though Hitler in fact survived the hail of bullets, he was arrested and locked in a cell at Landsberg prison. At first he was so depressed he refused to eat. Then his confidence returned as he discovered that the failed uprising had made him a local hero. At the trial, Hitler rounded on his accusers. He told the judges who gave him a prison sentence, "History will tear to tatters the verdict of this court."
You have been accused of high treason and called an enemy of the state.
If I am guilty of anything, then I am guilty of fighting to defend the rights of the German.
After the propaganda triumph at his trial, Hitler set out to write the Bible of National Socialism. He dictated much of the text here in his cell to his faithful follower, Rudolf Hess. On Saturday evenings, the other prisoners sat around as Hitler read out the completed chapters to them. The book as a whole dwells on the great obsessions which had come to dominate Hitler's political thought: the Jews, racism, living space for the German people, the evils of communism and parliamentary democracy. But it also includes Hitler's views on a variety of other topics, ranging from boxing to syphilis. The amazing appeal Hitler was later to exercise was his mastery of the spoken word. After prison, the leader, or Führer as he now called himself, had a new political strategy. Instead of planning another coup, he aimed to win power at the polls. What was to win him millions of votes was instead his vision of a great national revival. Hitler's election opportunity came with the onset of the Depression. In a few years, one in three of the labor force was out of work. Ilse Wendel was a church social worker during the Depression among the unemployed in the Berlin slums.
The despair was so terrible as I can't describe it. You had everywhere beggars. Wherever you went in Berlin, you had beggars.
The democratic political parties offered no solution. To millions of Germans, the only hope was Adolf Hitler.
Have you been to the marketplace? Do you know how much it costs for a loaf of bread these days?
500,000 marks. 500,000 marks. The wheelbarrows aren't big enough to carry the money in.
He's afraid I'll stir things up. You tell Commissar Carr. This is not a time for silence.
I supported Hitler because he, after having seen all that depravity, all that poverty here, was the only one who could do social justice to the people here.
He had that ability, the ability derived from his readiness to throw himself totally open, to appear, as it were, bare and naked before his audience, to tear open his heart and display it, to throw on a few extra generators and suddenly become absolutely charged with energy.
Und billige Versprechungen geben. It wasn't as though he was using words. It's as though the emotions came direct without words, almost. There was a rawness about it, a power.
$6.5 million, 107 seats.
Biggest party in the Reichstag. Get me Hitler.
Nobody has ever had this power to move on. This is him. Nobody says it the way he says it.
Hitler comes to power, not as he had hoped through outright victory at the polls, but as head of a coalition government. As this withering glance suggests, Hitler despises his coalition partners. He quickly outmaneuvers them and establishes his own dictatorship.
A month after he comes to power, the Reichstag building, the parliament building in Berlin, is set on fire. This happens to come at the time when he is constantly insisting that there is a communist plot to overthrow the new government and to carry out a revolution. And the Reichstag fire goes up in flames, which everybody can see. Before that night was over, he had got a set of decrees drawn up which transformed the situation politically. All the guarantees in which people in any democratic state, the freedom of speech, so on, freedom from arrest, all this is swept away.
A majority of Germans tolerate the burning of books, the banning of other political parties, and the setting up of a police state, because Hitler offers a way out of the depression.
If he's doing things which are not so good, which haven't, then he said, well, you have to take the rough with the smooth. Dictatorship seemed to be the only way to get out of the mess. So I thought that was a good thing that they cut away all this nonsense and rather did something, really did something, and that's what Hitler did.
He eliminated the crushing unemployment that Germany suffered. And he gave millions of people new confidence and indeed welfare. They were doing better, much better.
They came in their tens of thousands, full of youthful idealism, to worship the Führer in the awesome surroundings of the Nuremberg Stadium. Among the worshippers in the Hitler Youth was Alfons Heck, now a writer on the Nazi period.
The decisive turning point in my life occurred at the age of 10. From that moment on, I would remain beholden to Adolf Hitler long until after our defeat. I was one of 82,000 members of the Hitler Youth lined up in the Zeppelin's field. I stood in the first row. And when Hitler began to speak, we were just tingling with nervousness, finally to see our God. When he appeared on the podium, I was afraid to look at my neighbor because I didn't want him to see the tears in my eyes. My knees were shaking. And Hitler beamed down on us. He calmed us down by lifting his hands, both hands, several times. When he began to speak, it was in a very conversational tone. Man to boy, father to son.
Und ich weiß, das kann nicht anders sein. Denn ihr seid Fleisch von unserem Fleisch und Blut, von unserem Blut. Und in euren jungen Gehirn brennt derselbe Geist, der uns beherrscht.
And he said how fortunate we were to live in this new age. And he said, from now on, you no longer have to fear any class distinction. You're all one. But the essence and the emphasis occurred in the final sentences. He leaned over the podium, and I know he looked straight into my eyes, and he said, you, my boys, the young of Germany, live in a fortunate time. Because you are the standard bearers of the movement. You will inherit what we have so far created. And from that moment on, without any doubt, I was bound to Adolf Hitler, long until after our defeat.
Vor uns liegt Deutschland, in uns marschiert Deutschland, und hinter uns kommt Deutschland!
The mid-1930s were the halcyon years of Hitler's Germany. Germany was at peace, her prosperity restored, her national pride recovered. To those prepared to ignore or justify the police state, it seemed a beautiful Germany. A host of distinguished foreign visitors, many with impeccable democratic credentials, came to call on the Führer at his mountain retreat, the Berghof. Among them was the former British Prime Minister, David Lloyd George. With LG was his secretary, Albert Sylvester.
Hitler ran down the flight of stairs to welcome LG as he got out of his car, shook hands with him most warmly, and conducted us into the inside of the Berghof. This massive room, the only light of which came from a massive window, which was terrific. I'd never seen such a window. Lloyd George said, you have done great things for Germany. You have restored her honor, and you have gained for her equal rights.
I've met a few. Armchair politicians care more about their money than they do their own country.
Thank you.
I think that in some period around the end of 37-38, Hitler feels, well, this is fine, but I didn't come to power just to restore German self-confidence and so on. There's more. He changes gear, I think. And then he sweeps, you know, there is getting rid of a number of the old guard in the army and the foreign office and so on. And he becomes more aggressive.
Since coming to power, his aim was first to unite all the German-speaking peoples in a greater Germany. Hitler's first step was union with Austria, the country of his birth. In March 1938, German troops crossed the Austrian border to be welcomed by ecstatic crowds.
Und dieses Volk kommt nicht zum Reich in einer demütigenden Rolle. Ich selber führe euch ein.
It was the 12th of March, 1938. Austria was showered with swastikas. He crossed the border near his birthplace at Braunau. The people rejoiced at the fulfillment of an old dream of the German nation, the Anschluss, an emphatic display of self-determination, a right denied to the German people under the Versailles Treaty, whose terms were considered unjust. Visibly moved, he entered Vienna, and the city that had seen his early failures now gave him a hero's reception. Homage was being paid to the man who had achieved the unification of the German people.
It was here, far from the millions of his followers, that Hitler felt most able to relax. The inner circle at the Berghof saw a quite different man from the charismatic Führer of the party rallies. Life at Hitler's retreat was both reassuring and agreeable. And there was an entertaining side to the off-duty Führer, as Ribbentrop's private secretary discovered.
I was overwhelmed by the possibility to meet the Führer personally. And for instance, he was a sort of a messiah for me. He was a man who liked a joke, He could laugh a lot. He didn't accept two sort of jokes. Dirty jokes and political jokes. They were banned. But all the other jokes he enjoyed terribly.
Hitler had no close friends in whom to confide his innermost feelings. He could never admit human weakness to anyone. But the inner circle discovered one secret of his private life, which was unknown to ordinary Germans.
When Hitler was talking for hours and I was standing near to the wall, waiting until they want some papers or something, and the curtain opened and Eva Braun appeared and said, "Adolf, we must have luncheon now." Him with political questions, and he didn't want to give her influence, and he thought that as long as he is a bachelor, he has the love from the German women, because if he's married, the impression is not the same on the other women. And she gave him a little bit a home of a bourgeois quality, with tea, with cake, and I think with sex.
You think it was a sexual relationship?
Certainly.
The basis of this new, multi-ethnic country called Czechoslovakia was the Treaty of Versailles and the Treaty of Saint-Germain, which clearly stated that the national minorities are to have internal autonomy. As early as 1920, the new Czech constitution abolishes the right to self-determination for the minority Germans, Hungarians, and Poles. Consequently, the minorities become culturally and economically more and more oppressed. Beginning in May 1938, attacks by ethnic Czechs against the German minority increase dramatically, and consequently, the Sudeten German representative publicly demands the reunification of the Sudetenland with the German Reich. The government in Prague, however, responds by declaring martial law over all of the 13 Sudeten provinces, thus prompting Hitler to demand the return of the Sudeten territories to the German Reich.
Herr Schenner, ein Angebot gemacht. Es ist nichts anderes als Ihre Regierung, etwas ersetzt soll. Gucken Sie, hat. Er hat jetzt in seiner Hand Frieden oder Krieg. Er wird
Hitler planned to invade Czechoslovakia, to free the German minority there. The conference tried to find a peaceful solution. Nowadays, Munich is remembered as a German victory and a humiliating act of appeasement by Britain and France. At the time, Hitler felt he had been deprived of a war of conquest.
Hitler didn't like this Munich conference because he had the feeling that he was cheated of his smashing Czechoslovakia, and Hitler was very much annoyed by this sort of democratic conversation.
The British Prime Minister Neville Chamberlain flew home to a hero's welcome in London, waving a piece of paper signed by Hitler. It meant, he said, not only peace with honor, but peace for our time. Though Hitler disliked the Munich Agreement, it made him more popular than ever. A wave of relief and gratitude for the Führer swept Germany. His iron nerve had freed the Germans in Czechoslovakia and yet averted war.
The U.S. State Department, in its three-volume report on the origins of communism in Russia, published in 1931, reveals how Jewish-controlled German banks, under the leadership of Max Warburg, conspired as early as 1914 to send large payments to Lenin, Trotsky, and others in their attempts to bring down the Tsar. When the white Russian patriots heroically attempted to regain their freedom from the Jews, the Judaica says compact Jewish masses were utilized by the Bolsheviks to suppress such counter-revolution. Clearly, Jews and native Russians were engaged in a death struggle over the destiny of Russia. Unfortunately, the Jewish masses won. The Jewish masses won. The Jewish masses won.
We will survive. That's what they tell us. What they mean is, they will survive. We surrendered in November, at a time when we were perched on the edge of victory. Betrayed by the cowards and the traitors within our ranks. How do we fight them? We unite. We must join together for a greater Germany. We will hang the profiteers, crush the communists. We will disinfect our country of the Jewish vermin. Sacrifice. We will struggle, yes, but only then will we triumph, and we will triumph!
Was the year in which World War I broke out. Within 2 years, Germany had won that war. Not alone won it nominally, but won it actually. The German submarines, which were a surprise to the world, had swept all the convoys from the Atlantic Ocean, and Great Britain stood there without ammunition for her soldiers. At that time, the French army had mutinied. They lost 600,000 of the flower of the French youth on the Somme. The Russian army was defecting. They didn't like the Tsar. And the Italian army had collapsed. Not a shot had been fired on the German soil. Not an enemy soldier had crossed the border into Germany. And yet, here was Germany offering England peace terms. Well, England, in the summer of 1916, was considering that. Seriously, they had no choice. While that was going on, the Zionists in Germany, who represented the Zionists from Eastern Europe, and they said, we will guarantee to bring the United States into the war as your ally, to fight with you on your side, if you will promise us Palestine after you win the war. The price you must pay us is Palestine after you have won the war and defeated Germany, Austria-Hungary, and Turkey.
They made that promise in October of 1916, and that was called the Balfour Declaration. The Balfour Declaration was merely Great Britain's promise to pay the Zionists what they had agreed upon as a consideration for getting the United States into the war. That is where all the trouble starts.
Above all, we must remove the Jews. They run our banks. They lost us the war. They alone are responsible for the economic disaster in Europe.
Who alone are responsible for the moral decadence that now riddles our society? The Jews! The Jews! But who are now, and who have always been, unwelcome, unwanted, and they are everywhere!
November 1938. The Nazis organize a great anti-Jewish pogrom, the Night of the Broken Glass. All over Germany, synagogues are burnt, shop windows are broken.
Certainly, we wanted the Jews out of Germany.
When you ask what have the Germans done to the Jews, you must always ask what have done the Jews to the Germans. Since 1850, they have done three things which are really dramatic. Number one, they were a small minority of 2% of the population. At the time when Hitler came to power, 500,000 within 60 million German people. This small minority managed to control about 50% of the media, about 70% of all judges, to have a tremendous influence in movie and in theater and in literature. They were overrepresented. This is one thing. They were absolutely overrepresented, as today in England, in France, and in the United States. Second, Jews were at the origin of a lot of catastrophic financial bank crashes in Germany between 1870 and 1920. This is all documented. I mean, it's not Nazi propaganda or anti-Semitic or Arab propaganda. It's a lot of books have been published, even by Jewish Germans, about this problem. They have millions of German fathers have lost their incomes, their fortune, their savings, because of these Jewish gangsters, bank gangsters and speculation people. Then the third point, which was psychologically the most dangerous of all, they have introduced into German art and culture and theater and movie decadence, immorality. The first homosexual theaters, plays, were made in Berlin in the 1920s. The first adultery theater plays were made in the 1880s and 1890s, 100 years ago, by Jewish authors. Adultery, then sexual perversions of all sorts, sadism, masochism, lot of homosexuality, all these things, and then decadent art, you know, an art which is absolutely ridiculous, so-called modern art. It was all pushed by Jewish intellectuals, and this created among the German people a big revolt. And there were furious reactions in Germany. And this is why Adolf Hitler came to power. And within 2 years, he brought 6 million unemployed Germans back into their jobs. He created 6 million jobs. It's incredible.
Wir haben ein deutsches Theater, einen deutschen Film, eine deutsche Presse, ein deutsches Schrifttum, eine deutsche bildende Kunst und einen deutschen Rundfunk. Der früher oft gegen uns vorgebrachte Einwand, es gäbe keine Möglichkeit, die Juden aus dem Kunst- und Kulturleben zu beseitigen, weil deren zu viele seien und wir die leeren Plätze nicht neu besetzen könnten, ist glänzend widerlegt worden.
Secret negotiation between the Nazis and the Zionists in 1933, which allowed German Jews and their assets to go to Palestine.
A group of Zionists at the same time was quietly negotiating an agreement with the Nazis to allow the immigration of German Jews and the transfer of their assets to Palestine. That deal, reported in August 1933, was the transfer agreement. Palestine, sparsely settled by Jews at the time, was radically changed as a result.
I lived in Palestine from 1933 to 1936, and we saw every week transports of German Jews coming to settle in Palestine.
German-Jewish settlement of Palestine was, for a time, official Nazi policy. These photos of Jewish life in Palestine, along with a lengthy text, appeared in 1934 in the Berlin paper Der Angriff. The publisher, Hitler's propaganda minister, Joseph Goebbels. A Nazi Visits Palestine was the title of the multi-part series. A medal was struck by Goebbels in commemoration. On one side, the swastika. On the other, the Star of David. Hitler demanded one concession for the transfer agreement, that the call for a boycott of the Reich raised by Jews here and elsewhere be rejected by the Zionists. The Zionists made that concession.
the Allied leaders were arguing their way over the whole future of the German people. Under their hands, the map of Europe was drawn and redrawn again. At last, after more than 3 months of discussion, they presented the terms of their treaty to the Germans. Germany lost land in the east, the west, and the north. In the east, the most important of those losses was the wide strip of territory given to the newly independent Poland, separating East Prussia from the rest of Germany. While on the west, France took back the provinces of Alsace and Lorraine, and was also given the right to mine coal in the Saar, an area placed under League of Nations control for 15 years. To protect France, Germany was forbidden to station soldiers in the Rhineland, an area which was to be occupied by Allied troops until 1935. It was not only the loss of territory which Germany resented, but also the fact that Czechoslovakia and Poland now contained large numbers of Germans. And as if to add insult to injury, the treaty forbade German-speaking Austria to unite with Germany. Her fortifications were to be destroyed. Her army was to be reduced to 100,000 men. No air force, no submarines, and to accept blame for starting the war and pay reparations. So, in the high summer of 1919, the German delegates were brought to the Great Hall of Mirrors at Versailles to sign the peace treaty. It was a compromise peace that satisfied not even one single Allied leader, and predictably the Germans loathed it. The Germans argued that the Germany to which they were returning had suffered poverty and unemployment in the years since the war, and couldn't afford the vast sums demanded by the Allies. But these arguments didn't impress the Allies, who fixed the sum of £6,600 million for the Germans to pay. That sum would have to be paid in goods as well as money. Most would come from here in the Ruhr, the industrial heart of Germany. But at the end of 1922, the Germans fell behind with their payments, and Raymond Poincaré, the new French Prime Minister, decided to act. If Germany wouldn't pay in full and on the nail, then France would help herself. So on the 11th of January 1923, French and Belgian troops entered the Ruhr to force the Germans to pay up. There was, of course, after Versailles, no German army big enough to stop them. At first, the French believed that they could make the Germans work for them. But suddenly, German politicians and people were united in a common cause, hatred of the French. And huge protest meetings were held all over Germany. Their attitude towards the Germans in the Ruhr began to harden. They tried to cut the Ruhr off from the rest of the country. German visitors were searched as if they were entering a foreign land. ...1923 was disastrous for Germany. In that year, the great German inflation reached its peak. For some time, the value of the mark had been dropping. As the value of the notes decreased, so the amount of notes needed to buy things grew. Banks became more and more hard-pressed to meet the ever-increasing demand for paper money. For their customers, suitcases replaced wallets. As Germany slid towards disaster, Gustav Stresemann was appointed Chancellor. The loss of production in the Ruhr was making inflation even worse, and Stresemann realized that the only way to help the economy back to normal was to call off resistance there and get production going again. The government also announced that Germany would resume the payment of reparations. It was the only possible way of getting the French out. But to the nationalists, it looked like yet another pathetic surrender to Germany's enemies. General Ludendorff, who'd never accepted that Germany had been defeated, gave his support to Adolf Hitler, the leader of the new National Socialist Party.
Until 1934, conflicts between Germany and Poland smoldered. In the previous year, just after Hitler had won the elections, Polish head of state Marshal Pilsudski several times sought to enlist France for the purpose of effecting a bilateral attack against Germany. France, however, declined to participate, and so Poland eventually changed tactics. In 1934, a friendship treaty was signed, introducing a period of closer diplomatic relations, but under the surface, disputes were still simmering. Danzig, in particular, situated on the Baltic coast next to East Prussia, had been completely cut off from the Reich and became the new focus of political attention. Of the 370,000 inhabitants of Danzig, 97% were Germans and just 3% other nationals, primarily Poles. Irrespective of this fact, Warsaw continued to try to wrest total control over the strategically important harbor city. The German demand for reunification of Danzig constitutes just one of the three reasons that would lead to the coming war between Germany and Poland. In West Prussia, which was taken from the Reich and given to Poland with the Versailles Treaty, the situation was similar. Due to the loss of West Prussia, East Prussia was now completely cut off from Germany. This untenable situation would, thus, constitute the second of the three reasons for the eventual outbreak of what would become World War II. Even as Germany is still looking for a peaceful settlement, Poland is already thinking seriously about war. In February, the Polish General Staff develops guidelines for military operations against Germany. On March 4th, the so-called Main Staff begins planning for Operation West, a full month before Hitler orders the leadership of the Wehrmacht for an attack against Poland. At this point, the World War I Allies have already placed their bets on the outcome of this game. As early as March 1939, London and Paris guaranteed their support to Warsaw in the event that the Danzig and Corridor questions would develop into a military confrontation. Bolstered by English and French guarantees of war support, Poland has no further incentive to negotiate in good faith with Germany, and in the meantime, in Warsaw, maps are suddenly starting to circulate, which contain a new western Polish border extending to just west of Berlin. All across Poland, the so-called pogroms against the minorities begin. Ethnic Germans are physically assaulted, their farms torched. In Galicia, Ukrainians are detained, while Germans are forcibly deported by the thousands. German stores are boycotted, and on three separate occasions, Polish air defenses open fire upon German Lufthansa civilian airline transport planes en route to Königsberg. Ethnic Germans now become a wave of refugees. Night after night, Polish border officials shot at the fleeing Germans. Nonetheless, many would try to make their way to safety and freedom. Shortly before the official outbreak of war, there were already 80,000 ethnic Germans in refugee camps in both Danzig and the German Reich. Hitler, on numerous occasions, advised the English and the French administration that, with regard to this drama, a solution to the German-Polish question cannot be delayed anymore. The misery of the minority Germans in Poland, 1939, had now developed the third and most pressing reason that would lead to the outbreak of World War II.
Hitler now has a problem that Britain and France will declare war on them. At this point, Poland is actually committing pretty bad atrocities against the German minority in West Prussia, in the German part of Poland at that time. And so given that Poles are committing atrocities against the German minority in Poland, Hitler is now at a very tough situation. Basically, it's like, all right, if I don't declare war on Poland, if I don't go in and help these Germans out, well then the German minority is just going to keep getting slaughtered. And it's not an insignificant amount of Germans in that area who were being killed. I mean, it was pretty bad what was going on, what the Poles were doing in that area. And so he was basically saying, well, if we don't go in, then those Germans are just going to keep getting slaughtered. If we go in, well then we're going to find ourselves at war with Poland, France, and Britain, and possibly the Soviet Union.
But in a move of brilliant cunning, he astonished the world in the summer of 1939 by doing a deal with Stalin. With Stalin on his side, Hitler was sure nobody else would interfere when he attacked the Poles.
Whilst the military commissions of the Western powers are still negotiating in Moscow with a view of enlisting Russia in their front against Germany, Reich Foreign Minister von Ribbentrop flies to the Soviet capital to sign a pact of non-aggression and consultation with Monsieur Stalin and Foreign Commissar Molotov.
The applause greets the Fuhrer who has just arrived in the full upper house to address the Reichstag, which has been called an extraordinary session. Danzig was and is a German city. Have only Germany to thank for their cultural development.
Wenn Polen versuchen sollte, auf dem Weg zollpolitischer Maßnahmen Danzig wirtschaftlich zu vernichten, dass dann Deutschland nicht mehr länger untätig zusehen könnte.
I told the Polish ambassador 3 weeks ago that if situation continued as it was, if Danzig were persecuted and it were attempted by Poland to ruin Danzig economically, the situation could not be tolerated.
We interrupt this broadcast of Adolf Hitler's speech just momentarily to report a dispatch from Paris which says that Premier Daladier of France has now called the French Council of Ministers for an emergency meeting.
Ich habe mich daher nun entschlossen, mit Polen in der gleichen Sprache zu reden, mit der Polen und der Polen.
I therefore resolve to speak to Poland in the same language in which Poland has addressed us for such a long time.
Sie wissen, dass Russland und Deutschland von zwei verschiedenen Doktrinen regiert werden. Es war nur eine Frage, die geklärt werden musste.
Once again, we interrupt very briefly this talk by Chancellor Hitler to announce that in London, Parliament has been summoned to meet at 6 p.m. in London.
Heute Nacht zum ersten Mal auf unserem eigenen Territorium auch mit bereits regulären Soldaten geschossen.
Poland, for the first time this evening, has shot at regular soldiers upon our territory.
Und von jetzt ab wird Bombe mit Bombe vergolten.
From now on, bomb will be met by bomb.
I am speaking to you from the cabinet room at 10 Downing Street. This morning, the British ambassador in Berlin handed the German government a final note stating that unless we heard from them by 11 o'clock, that they were prepared at once to withdraw their troops from Poland, a state of war would exist between us. I have to tell you now that no such undertaking has been received, and that consequently this country is at war with Germany.
ich als Soldat des Weltkrieges, der ich nur im Westen gekämpft habe, nie kennen zu lernen, Gelegenheit hatte. Tausende von niedergemetzelten Volksdeutschen, physisch abgeschlachteten Frauen, Mädchen und Kindern, unzählige deutsche Soldaten und Offiziere, die als Verwundete in die Hände dieses Gegners gefallen sind. Sie wurden massakriert, Augen ausgestochen, bestialisch verstümmelt. Und das Schlimmste, diese polnische Regierung hat das in ihren eigenen Rücken ganz offen zugegeben. Das abspringende Soldaten der Luftwaffe ermordet worden sind.
A general war. What he wanted, and I have no doubt about this, he wanted a war to destroy Poland. That he was prepared for a moment he was disconcerted to find that he might be involved in war with Britain and France, because this had never been his plan. He had always regarded Britain as his natural ally. But in the end he accepted, look, I have a Nazi-Soviet pact which guarantees that this will not develop into a general. I should be able to knock Poland out in 3 weeks, which he more or less did. After that, the West isn't going to start up a war again.
Thank you.
6 weeks, a German blitzkrieg defeats France and forces Britain to evacuate its troops from the continent. Paris is Hitler's.
France asked Hitler for an armistice. Shortly before 3 o'clock on the afternoon of June the 21st, 1940, he arrived in the forest of Compiègne. Hitler himself took the seat where Marshal Foch had sat. The French delegation, led by General Hunziker, followed closely behind. When the French entered the carriage, Hitler could fully relish the peak of his career. Long ago, on entering politics, he had sworn never to rest until the shame of November 1918 had been wiped out. Now he had done it. The dream of his lifetime, he said, had been fulfilled. Berlin greeted him with flowers and jubilation. Hitler's triumphal return to Berlin is in a flood of respect and adulation.
The shirts were swaying all day, and the mood of elation really penetrated throughout the country.
My feelings towards Hitler were such as if he were some superhuman being between man and a god sent by providence.
This was the man who had obliterated the humiliation of the First World War.
Germany was absolutely in a position to direct the course of the war. All we had to defeat now, we believed, was Britain.
The German fighter ace Adolf Galland also thinks the next priority is the Battle of Britain. But when he meets Hitler, he discovers that the Führer's priorities are different.
I talked to him that our good time would come and we could bomb London and the fighters couldn't, English fighters couldn't take off. And they said, no. Stop this. I don't like this. I really don't like the fight against England. The English people are so similar people to the Germans. And I have the highest respect for the English building up an empire. So you must understand, I'm forced to fight this fight against England. But I don't like it.
I think that he himself had not got any great wish to engage on an invasion of Britain, because
All the time, by now, we know he was already beginning to turn eastwards after defeating France. But Goering insisted that with the Luftwaffe, with the Air Force alone, he could knock Britain out. So he gave him his head to try. And that was a decisive defeat. But it was not really a setback to Hitler's main plan.
This is Edward Murrow speaking from London. There were more German planes over the coast of Britain today than at any time since the war began. Anti-aircraft guns were in action along the southeast coast. By an overwhelming majority, Congress passed Lend-Lease, Bill number 1776.
I ask this Congress for authority and for funds sufficient to manufacture additional munitions and war supplies of many kinds to be turned over to those nations which are now in actual war with aggressor nations. Our most useful and immediate role is to act as an arsenal for them as well as for ourselves. We shall send in ever-increasing numbers ships, planes, tanks, guns. That is our purpose and our pledge.
Thank you.
Stalin came to power on the death of Lenin and ruled the Soviet Union by fear and torture for nearly the next 30 years. During that time, he was responsible for some 40 million deaths. Stalin spent his first years in power consolidating his position. He managed to sideline Trotsky, whom he perceived as his major rival. In 1929, Stalin implemented a policy known as collectivization. Lenin's experiment in nationalizing the land had remained half-finished, and Russian peasants were still working their own land and selling their own produce in the market. By means of collectivization, Stalin meant to complete Lenin's initiative and to take away all the peasants' lands and produce in the name of the state. In 1930, peasants' produce began to be collected up. The Red Army, one by one, seized the produce from every single field. Some peasants managed to hide their goods rather than give them up. But Communist Party officials searched every nook and cranny, eventually discovering the hiding places. The officials also seized the peasants' agricultural equipment. The peasants were left with nothing to eat and nothing to work the soil with. Eventually, that catastrophe that Lenin had described as the most useful for communism raised its head again, famine. In Ukraine alone, 6 million people starved over the next few years. 2 million died in Kazakhstan, and 1 million in northern Caucasus. Children reduced to skin and bone died in agony. There was another ghastly result of the famine inspired by Stalin. Cannibalism. Peasants maddened by hunger began to eat corpses. Then an even worse horror emerged. Some peasants had kidnapped children and eaten them. In front of these two Russian peasants, caught eating human flesh, lay the remains of the children they had snatched. Stalin's regime had turned human beings into savage animals, just as communism had intended. Everyone who opposed Stalin's collectivization policy paid with his life. Tens of thousands of kulaks were detained and shot. In actual fact, the regime branded everyone it saw as opposed to its ideology as kulaks. Large numbers of priests and even members of their congregations who attended church frequently were arrested as kulaks. Some were executed. Others were sent to the labor camps, where a slow, lingering death awaited them. These camps were set up all over Russia and were simply another of Stalin's killing machines. Millions of people regarded as enemies of the state were worked to death in them under the most terrible conditions. Some were put to work laboring on canals in the blazing heat. Others were sent off to break rocks in the freezing cold of Siberia. These people, forced to perform hard labor under the worst possible conditions, soon turned into living skeletons. The great majority never left the camps alive.
The Soviet Union, like every communist country, was an economic basket case. It could not produce enough to survive. And so every communist socialist state has been dependent upon aid from the capitalist producing states. So Russia was desperate for our aid, both in terms of direct government aid, but also in terms of opening up the spigots for the private capital markets, particularly New York bankers and corporations, to move into Russia in a big way.
In 1933, the Roosevelt administration invited a Soviet representative to Washington to negotiate terms of diplomatic recognition.
Hans Frank is appointed Governor General of Poland, and the country disappears from the headlines of the world press. Jews must wear the Star of David on their arms, not carry it in their pockets. In Warsaw, there is a streetcar exclusively for Jews. In October 1940, a district a mile and a half square is transformed into a ghetto. 240,000 Jews and 80,000 non-Jews live there. Thank you.
June the 22nd, 1941. Operation Barbarossa. Hitler's offensive takes the German people as well as the Russian army by surprise.
From the Baltic to the Black Sea, 3 million German soldiers are moving into position to launch Operation Barbarossa. The most brutal conflict between two nations in recorded history is about to begin. On the first day of Barbarossa alone, 1,200 Soviet aircraft are destroyed in a single strike. Panzer units sweeping east are already deep inside Soviet territory. Chaos multiplies the catastrophe. Without orders from the Kremlin, Red Army field commanders lose control of their units. Dazed, cut off, surrounded, thousands of Soviet soldiers surrender. And at the height of the Wehrmacht's ferocious onslaught, Stalin disappears completely. He has every reason to hide from his people. Captured German newsreel footage shows Soviet frontier troops overwhelmed. A retreat under fire in total confusion. Whole formations surrendering. Hundreds of thousands of men entangled with fleeing civilians in scenes of biblical disorder. Yet there are some Soviet citizens who welcome the invader. To many in the Ukraine, the arrival of the Germans is a heaven-sent opportunity to throw off Stalin's yoke. Local women bless the Germans as they pass. Their menfolk destroy reminders of a man who has terrorized them for years. Stalin is above all stunned by the sheer speed of the German advance. Still, the Germans drive east. They are at the outskirts of Kiev, Smolensk, and Leningrad. Yet fierce pockets of Red Army resistance fight on behind enemy lines. The fortress city of Brest. The besieged Red Army garrison fights on and on for more than a month until they are finally compelled to surrender. Hitler is so impressed by the tenacity of the Russian troops that he exercises rare clemency. Only one survivor is shot, the political officer at the fortress, Mikhail Fomin. The Führer cites the defense of Brest as an heroic effort, an example to his own soldiers. And he visits the fortress with Mussolini to acknowledge a hard-earned victory. But for Stalin, the defenders of Brest are not heroes. Years later, after their release from German capture, he will send survivors to the Gulag. The Wehrmacht's rapid, relentless advance seems unstoppable. Traveling at up to 50 miles a day, panzer divisions are already approaching the heart of Stalin's empire. And in the middle of July, Stalin is forced to consider offering the Germans a negotiated peace. While Stalin contemplates a way out of the war, he's drawing up plans to punish his own troops if they surrender. In a desperate attempt to halt the rout, he issues order number 270. All officers and political officials taken prisoner at the front are to be considered traitors. If ever they return to the Soviet Union, they will be arrested and executed. But the barbarity of Order 270 does not stop there. The wives of captured troops also face imprisonment in the Gulag. Now, with Moscow in range of the Luftwaffe, Stalin's own citadel of power comes directly under attack. German armies race for the capital. Elsewhere, Army Group North heads for Leningrad. Army Group Center makes a pincer movement towards Smolensk. Army Group South strikes towards Kiev and the Ukraine. The suburbs of Kiev, the beginning of August. In a vast pincer movement, German Army Group South threatens to encircle the city. During August and the first 2 weeks of September, the Wehrmacht encircles a vast area crammed with Red Army troops. Four Soviet armies perish. On the 18th of September, the city falls. The Führer is now lord of all he surveys. It seems as if he is on course to meet his objective, to crush Stalin's Russia before winter sets in. Leningrad lies ahead of the Wehrmacht, defenseless. As September draws to a close, Leningrad is totally cut off, with no land link left to the Soviet Union. At the end of September, the Führer launches Operation Typhoon, the final drive along the road to Moscow. 14 German tank and 74 infantry divisions, a total of 1.8 million officers and men, take part in the offensive. Stalin has good cause for panic now. Facing a disaster that might sweep away the whole Soviet Union, they have one last hope that the weather will save them. Sleet is turning to snow. The ground, frozen at night, is now a quagmire during the day, paralyzing Hitler's overstretched war machine. On the 2nd of December, German units reach Krasnaya Polyana, 17 miles from the center of Moscow. As the weather intensifies and temperatures plummet, the bleak truth is time turns decisively against them.
Two army privates running the Opana radar station are suddenly startled by blips on the screen. 50 planes headed for Oahu. Immediately, they report the sightings to the Army Operations Center. They're dismissed as U.S. planes coming from the mainland. Aircraft designated for the second wave of the attack take off. Messenger boy Todeo Fuchikami picks up General Marshall's urgent cable for delivery to General Short. Commander Fuchida's first wave armada is on course. Sleepy-eyed sailors and marines, their breakfast getting cold, mistake the attack for some crazy kind of air raid drill. They think the planes are American. At 7:55 a.m., dive bombers hit Hickam and Wheeler airfields. Two minutes later, torpedo planes start their run on Battleship Rome. 3 minutes later, zero strafe other air bases. It's Fushida's first wave of aircraft that hits the Arizona, which erupts like a volcano. Flames burst 500 feet into the air. Fushida's deadly first wave sinks the West Virginia. Now the Oklahoma, a battle wagon moored outboard of the USS Maryland, shudders with torpedo hits. She begins listing and capsizes. More torpedoes rip into the battleships California and Nevada. After the last bomb is dropped, the United States of America virtually has a Pacific fleet no longer. 8 battleships, 3 cruisers, 3 destroyers, and 4 auxiliary ships are sunk or damaged. Some 350 planes are damaged or destroyed. By mid-afternoon, the Western Union messenger delivers General Marshall's urgent top secret warning.
Yesterday, December 7th, 1941, a date which will live in infamy. United States of America was suddenly and deliberately attacked by naval and air forces of the Empire of Japan.